At the beginning, I wish that all of you are in good health and safe. Today in this lecture, we will start a new chapter, which is called the cost of capital, chapter 9 in your book. As we took in chapter 1, that the main goal of any firm is to maximize the shareholder wealth. In order to achieve this goal, we must study the cost of capital. We want to know the basic concepts, so let us first explain the basic concepts. First, what is meant by a cost of capital? Cost of capital represents the firm's cost of financing and is the minimum rate of return that a project must earn to increase the firm's value. What is capital? Capital is the firm's long-term sources of financing, which include both debt and equity. So the capital structure is the mix of debt and equity financing that a firm employs. The main concept and the basic concept we took in this chapter is the weighted average cost of capital, which is abbreviated by WACC. What is WACC? WACC is the weighted average of a firm's cost of debt and capital. This is the structure that the mix between debt and equity, where the weights reflect the percentage of each type of financing used by the firm, and we will explain that in the next slides. Let's start by an example to understand the concept. A firm is currently considering two investment opportunities. So, two financial analysts working independently of each other are evaluating these opportunities, assume the following information about investment A and investment B. Investment A, the cost of the investment is $100,000, the lifetime of the investment is 20 years, and the expected return is 7%. The first analyst that studied the first investment recalls that the company recently issued bonds paying a 6% rate of return. He reasons that because the investment project earned 7, while the firm can issue that at 6%, the project must be worth doing, so he recommends that the company undertake this investment. What did he do in this example? He compared between the cost of the bonds that is financing the project and the return of the investment. When he compared 7% return and the cost 6%, he suggested that he can accept this investment. Let us see investment B and the second financial analyst. The investment B, it's cost $100,000, a lifetime 20 years, and the expected return 12%. The second analyst assigned to this project, knows that the firm has common stock outstanding and that investors who hold the company stock expect a 14% return on their investment. So the rate of return required by the stockholders is 14%. The analyst decided that the firm should not undertake this investment because it produces only 10% return, while the company's shareholders expect a 14% return. So also this financial analyst compared also the cost 14%, which is the rate of return required by the shareholders, by the rate of return of this investment 12%. So he reject this investment because the cost is greater than the return. This example shows that each analyst is making a mistake by focusing on only one source of financing. The first one focused on the cost of debt, and the second one the cost of stocks, rather than an overall financing mix. What if instead the analyst used a combined cost of financing by weighting the cost of each source of financing by its relative proportion, and we will explain later in this slide what is meant by the relative proportion? The firm can obtain a weighted average cost of capital, the WACC. Let us see the example. Assume the firm desires a 50-50 mix of debt. 50% will be financed by debt and 50% will be financed by equity. So the WACC is 10%. How did we get this 10%? We took the 50% weight of the debt multiplied by its cost. 50% the weight of the debt times the cost of the debt, which is 6%, plus 50% the weight of the equity times the 14%, which is the cost of equity. We got 10% weighted average cost of capital. With this average cost of financing, the firm should reject the first opportunity, which will bring us a rate of return 7%, because in this case it will be lower than the 10% the cost of the weighted average cost, and accept the second investment, which give us 12% expected return because it is more than our cost of capital. Let us see our sources of long term. we have many sources, and we during the chapter we will learn how to calculate the cost of each source. What are the sources of long-term capital? Long-term capital is from four basic sources: long-term debt, preferred stock, common stock, and return earnings. These are the sources of long-term capital we will find at the left side of the balance sheet, where the liabilities. We ignore the short-term liabilities. We concentrate only on the long-term debt and the long-term equity, which is divided into the preferred stock, common stock, and new issuance of common stocks, and return earnings. The first source we will learn how to calculate its cost is the long-term debt. What is meant by long-term debt? Long-term debt is the financing. Is the new funds raised? Sorry, the cost of long-term debt is the financing cost associated with new funds raised through long-term borrowing. Long-term borrowing, as we know, just a loan from a bank or issuing bonds, which is the main which is the main topic of our chapter today. Issuing bonds. The first concept in the equation of calculating the cost of debt is net proceeds. What is meant by net proceeds? Net proceeds means that the funds actually received by the firm from the sale of a security. I mean, if the security is selling by 100%, by $100, and I paid a flotation cost and commissions and whatever, $20, I mean that what is the money, the actual money received by the firm is the $100 minus $20. So the net I received is called net proceeds. So again, net proceeds, what's meant by net proceeds? Net proceeds is the funds actually received by the firm from the sale of a security. What is the flotation cost? The flotation cost, the total cost of issuing and selling security, mean underwriting cost, commissions cost, administrative cost, all of these costs named flotation cost. Let us see this example. Deutsche Corporation, a major hardware manufacturer, is contemplating selling $10 million worth of 20-year, 6% coupon bonds, each with a par value of $1,000. Because bonds with similar risk earn returns equal to 6%, Deutsche's bonds will sell in the market at par value. So the par value of this bond is equal to $1,000. And they will have a yield to maturity equal to the coupon rate 6%. So 6% is its rate of return. However, Deutsche's will incur flotation cost equal to 2% of the par value of the bond. 2% is the flotation cost in terms of percentage, so I have to convert it to a dollar amount. How? By multiplying 2%, the flotation cost, times the par value. So to get the flotation cost, I have always to multiply the percentage times the par value. I have to use the par value. So in this case, the flotation costs are $20. The net proceeds to the firm, to calculate the net proceeds, I have to subtract flotation costs from the par value. I will get 980, 1,000 minus 20, equal 980, which is the net proceeds. Let us see the cost of long term. But before explaining the equations, I have to say that it is called before tax cost of debt, before the effect of tax. Before tax cost of debt is calculated by this equation: the annual interest in dollars, the letter I is abbreviated for interest rate, interest in terms of dollars, not as a percentage. 1,000 D mean I par value minus the net proceeds over and a number of years, lifetime of the investment. All of this over net proceeds again plus 1,000, which is the par value, over 2. So to calculate the before tax cost of debt, I have to memorize this equation: I, an annual interest in dollars, plus stress on that I have to calculate it in terms of dollars, not a percentage, as we will show that in the example. Plus 1,000 minus a net proceeds over L n, a number of years of the bond maturity, over net proceeds plus 1000 over 2. Let's solve it. Substituting the appropriate values, we know that from the example that the yield to maturity is 6%. So to calculate the interest, I multiply 6% times the par value, we get $60. So I, the interest in terms of dollars, equals $60 plus 1,000, which is the par value, minus the net proceeds as we calculated before, 1,000 minus 20, we get 980. Over 20, which is the number of years to maturity. Over again net proceeds plus 1,000 over 2 equals so 60 plus 1 over 990. So the before cost of before tax cost of debt equal 6.16%. This approximate value of before tax cost of debt is close to 6.17. But it lacks a perception of the value drift using the calculator or spreadsheet. This means that we can calculate it by many situations, by Excel, by many resources, yani the calculator or the spreadsheet, which is Excel or the financial calculator. So whatever source you use may be different due to approximations. After tax cost of debt, as we know that debt brings to us tax shield. The tax shield, I want to reflect this tax shield on the cost. So to calculate the after tax cost of debt, we multiply the before tax cost of debt times L1 minus the tax rate. The interest payments paid to bondholders are tax deductible for the firm, so the interest expense on that reduces the tax, the firm's taxable income. So here, to continue the equations, we got the before tax cost of debt 6.17. So we have to multiply it by 1 minus the tax rate. Here in this example, the tax rate is equal to 21%. We find that after tax cost of debt equal 4.88%. Debt is considered to be the least costly source of capital, is a relative inexpensive form of financing for two main reasons. First, the first reason is that is less risky than preferred or common stock. That alone makes debt a low cost form of financing because investors accept lower returns on bonds than on stock. We know that when the risk is low, the rate of return is low. When risk is higher, the rate of return maximizes. Second reason why the debt is relatively inexpensive, the firm enjoys a tax benefit from issuing debt that it does not receive when it uses equity capital. The second source is the preferred stock. How to calculate the cost of preferred stock? To calculate the cost of preferred stock, let us see the equation. It is equal to the dividends of the preferred stock over the net proceeds also. But the net proceeds of the P, there is a small letter of P denotes for the preferred stock, R, which is the cost of preferred stock, PD for preferred stock, equal the dividends of the preferred stock over net proceeds of the preferred stock. What do we mean by the preferred stock dividends? Preferred stock dividends, when companies issue preferred shares, the shares usually pay a fixed dividend and have a fixed par value. We know that from the accounting that preferred stock is different from the common stock, that it have a stated fixed dividends. So when the companies issue preferred stock, she paid for the preferred stockholders a stated or fixed dividend. To calculate the stock of the preferred stock equals this fixed dividend over the net proceeds after selling of the stock. Let us see the example. Also, the example is continued across the whole chapter. The same example, the same company. Deutsche Corporation is contemplating issuance of an 8% preferred stock. They expect to sell at par value for $80 per share. As a selling price of the preferred stock equal $80. The cost of issuing and selling the stock will be 2.50, so the flotation cost equal 2.50 per share. The first step in finding the cost of the stock is to calculate the dollar amount of the annual preferred dividends. It's also in this case board of the preferred stock, D must be in dollar amount, not a percentage. I can take 8% and put it in the equation, it is wrong. I have to convert it into dollar amount. How can I convert it? By multiplying 8% times its selling price, which is 80 in this case, to get 6.40 the devils. Stop. How to calculate the net proceeds? The net proceeds, the selling price is 80 and flotation cost is 2.50. So the net proceeds equals $77.50. We can now substitute in the equation of the cost. We substituted LDP by 6.40 and substituted net proceeds by 77.5. We got the cost of the preferred stock, which is 8.25%. This is easy one. This is the easiest cost of the force resources is the preferred stock. Now we can refer to the third source of the capital, which is the common stock. The cost of common stock equity is equal to the required return on the firm's common stock by investors in the marketplace. So the rate of return required by the stockholders is the cost for the company. As we know that as a coin, head and tail. Head of to a rate of return to the investors, tail is the cost from the other side to the firm. This cost possibly adjusted to account for cost of issuing new shares of stock. The two forms of common stock financing, I have two forms of common stock, which is the return earnings, the earnings returned from previous year's income, and the second source, if I drained from the return earnings, I can issue new common stocks to finance my projects. The cost of common stock equity is equal to the required return on the firm's common stock in the absence of flotation cost, but the cost of issuing new common equity is higher. Finding the cost of common stock equity, we can use two models to get to this cost. To calculate the cost of common stock, we have two models. The first model is the cost growth model evaluation, Jordan gross model. And the second one is the CAPM, capital asset pricing model, which is studied before in the last chapter 8. The first model, constant gross valuation, or the Jordan model. Let us see the equation. RS, this is the abbreviated for the required return on common stock, which is the cost of common stock. As we mentioned, that the rate of return for the investors is the cost for the firm. So the cost of the stock of common stock equal the dividends D1. This is dividend expected in 1 year. As we know that common stocks, we don't have a fixed stated dividends, we is a variable one. So the dividend for each year is different from the other year. In this equation, we want to calculate the dividend expected in 1 year over the price of the common stock plus G. What is G? G is the constant rate of gross in dividends. So again, how to calculate the common stock according to Jordan model? Equal dividends expected in 1 year over the price plus LG, which is the cross. This is of the last year, 3.8. Then over 2.98, all to the power 1/5. Minus 1. We got approximately 5%. So the gross rate is about 5%. I have here top. So I have here the price and the gross rate. How to calculate dividend 1, or is the dividend expected in the coming year? Dividend 1 equal D note times 1 plus G. I got 3.99. So again, dividend 1, how to calculate dividend 1, or dividend expected in the second year, or in the coming year, equal D note, which is 3.80, multiplied by 1 plus G, 1 plus 5% to get D1. We get it as 3.99 over P, which is price, $50, plus the gross rate, the whole 5%. So the cost of a common stock equal 12.98% or approximately 13%. CAPM, RF is the risk-free rate plus the beta, the market risk, times the market return minus the rate. To continue the example, Deutsche Corporation now wishes to calculate the required return on its common stock by using the CAPM. Here, he told me that he used to calculate the cost of capital of common stock using the CAPM. The firm investment advisors and its own analysts indicate that the risk-free rate equals 3%, so RF equals 3%. The firm's beta equals 1.5, and the market return equals 9%. Substituting these values in the equation of the CAPM model, we got 12%, because as we substitute RF by 3%, and the beta by 1.5, and the market return 9%. We got 12%, is a little bit different from the other model, but it's almost 1% the difference. Note that this estimate of the required return does not line up exactly with the estimate obtained from the constant gross model. It is a little bit different. That is to be expected because the two models rely on different assumptions. We use different assumptions in the two models. In practice, analysts at Deutsche might average the two figures to arrive at a final estimate for the required return on common stock. Sometimes the analysts use an average between the two calculations of the two models. Okay, cost of common stock. Comparing the constant gross and the CAPM techniques, the CAPM technique differs from the constant gross valuation model in that it directly considers the firm risk as reflected by BEAT. Using this model or using the CAPM technique, I consider the firm risk in determining the required return on common stock equity. The constant gross model does not look at risk directly during to the it's given. It does not look at risk. It uses an indirect approach to infer what return shareholders expect based upon the price they are willing to pay for the stock today, given estimates of the firm's future dividends. It's indirectly the risk, it is reflected in the price and in the future dividends, but it does not directly consider it as a given or in the assumption using the constant gross. Finally, the cost of common stock equity. Let us see if we want to issue new common stocks. We have to consider the flotation cost. In the previous example, as we calculated the common stock, the return earnings of the company, we does not consider the flotation cost because it is retained from other years. Here in this example, we will consider the flotation cost because we will issue new issuance of common stocks. Again, what is flotation cost? It's all the costs, underwriting, commissions, administrative costs, any cost I can pay it to issue and sell the common stock. So the cost of a new issuance of common stock, it is the cost net of underpricing and associated flotation costs. We will substitute P, the price, in the last equation by net proceeds. So the only difference between the returned earnings equation and the new common stock is a price in the previous in the return earnings equations. Here for the new issuance, we substituted by net proceeds for the new issuance. The dividend one is the same, the gross rate is the same, so the only difference is between the price and the net proceeds. When we issue a new stocks, we have to consider the flotation cost and subtract it from the price. So again, N, net of underpricing and flotation cost. D1 is the dividend expected in 1 year or the dividend expected in the coming year. LG is the gross. Let us see the example. In the constant gross valuation example, we found that Deutsche's required return on common stock was 13% using the following values. The expected dividend was D1 was 3.99, the current market price P equal 50 and an expected gross equal 5%. To determine its cost of new common stock, the corporation has estimated that on average new shares can be sold for 48. The corporation shares will be underpriced by $2 per share. So when the analyst tested the market, they found that they have to underprice the market price by $2, so the price is 48. Also, another kind of source is the flotation cost. Here, a second cost associated with a new issuance, it's a flotation cost, 1.50 per share. That will be paid to issue and sell the new shares. So the total underpricing and flotation cost per share are 3.50. Again, from where we get 3.5, from two kind of cost. The first cost, which is the underpricing, اضطريت اخفض البرايس اوف ذا اوف ذا ستوك. So I had to underprice it. I will sell it by 48 instead of 50. So I underprice the price by $2. The new price is 48. Plus the other kind of the other source of cost, which is the flotation cost, 1.50 per share. So the total underpricing and flotation cost is 3.50. So the net proceeds equal 50 minus 3.5. Subtracting the 3.5 per share underpricing and flotation cost from the current 50 share price results in expected net proceeds of 46.50. We then can substitute in the equations of the common, the new issuance of the common stock, that D1 equals 3.99 over in net proceeds, which is 46.5 plus the gross rate. We got 13.5. Deutsche Corporation's cost of new common stock is therefore between 13 and 14. 13, which is the cost of returned earnings, and 14, which is the cost of new issue. This slide ensures that the cost of returned earnings equal the required return on a firm's common stock, the normal common stock, not the new issuance. So LRR equal RS. LRS, the equations of the return earnings, which is we use price instead of net proceeds. Net proceeds only, we use a net proceeds in the calculation of the cost of new issuance. Let's see this example, the continuation of this, the same corporation. The cost of return equals the required return on equity. Recall that we calculated the required return using two methods. The constant gross model, we estimated the required return on equity to be 13%. Before accounting for flotation cost and underpricing, because it is the common stocks we remained with the company, not the new issuance, and with the cap M, the required return on equity was 12%. Thus, the cost of Deutsche Corporation's to financial investments through to return earnings falls somewhere in the range of 12 to 13%. Both estimates are lower than the cost of a new issue of common stock, because by using return earnings, the firm avoids the additional cost associated with issuing new equity. Let us come to the final step of the problem, which is how to calculate the weighted average cost of capital. The main idea of the chapter, how to calculate, as we know that it is a mistake to focus on only a source. I can get to the optimal mix between the debt and equity. So to finance any projects, I have to calculate the weighted average cost of capital. Let us see this equation. It is easy as the one we explained it at the first of the chapter, at the first two slides in the chapter. We mean the WACC, which is the weighted average cost of capital, equal the weight of debt times the weight of debt times the cost of debt, multiplied by one or minus tax rate to get it after tax cost, plus the weight of the preferred stock times is the cost of the preferred stock, plus the weight of common stocks times the cost of common stocks, either it is a new issuance or returned earnings. So W, abbreviated for the weight, we have the weights, the summation of the weights must be equal to 1. Yeah, for example, the capital to finance any the project with 100,000, 40% will be financed by debt. So for 40,000 will be get from issuing bonds. 10% from preferred stock, it means that 10,000 will be financed by preferred stock. The other 50% means that 50,000 will be financed from the common stock. So the total weights equal 1 or 100%. Let us see, calculating the weighted average cost of capital, few important points we have to stress on before we continue, that the weight must be non-negative and sum to 1. طبعا it مستحيل تبقى بالنيجاتيف, يعني الويت لازم must be positive number and sum to 1. The weights are based on the market value of each capital source as a percentage of the market value of the firm's total capital. The market value of the total capital, we multiply the firm's common stock equity weight by either the required return on the firm's stock or the cost of new common stock. Either the company will issue new common stock or the company will use its return earnings. According to this, we will use the main cost, either the common cost of return earnings or the cost of new issuance times the weight. The final point, we multiply the firm cost of debt by 1 minus t to capture the tax deduction tied to interest payments. Again, we stress that that makes for the firm tax shield, deduction في ال payments. So we have to reflect this on the cost. So we'll multiply the cost of debt by 1 minus t to capture the tax deduction tied to interest payments. Preferred stock, the only source of capital that is reflected or that achieve tax shield is only the debt. The other three sources does not reflect any tax shields. So the cost of three sources, the cost of debt equal for 4.88. The cost of preferred stock equal 8.26, and the cost of debt return earnings equal 13%. Deutsche has total capital with a market value 1 billion. The market value of the firm's outstanding long term is 400. The long term debt is 400 million. So to get or to calculate the weight of the debt, how can we get the weight of the debt? We took 400 over 1 billion, so we get 40% the weight of the debt. Also, the value of its preferred stock is 100 million. To get the weight of the preferred stock, we put 100 million over 1 billion to get the percentage, which is 10%. So the weights must be in percentage. The market value of its common stock is $500 million. So the weight of the common stock is 50%. From where I get the 50%, 500 million over 1 billion. Thus, the weights for the weighted average cost of capital calculation as follows. The long-term debt 40%, the preferred stock is 10%, and the common stock equity is 50%. The total of the weights is 100%. So, to continue this example and to finish it, I have to calculate the weighted average cost of capital for the which corporations. Because the firm expects to have a sizable amount of return earnings available, it plans to use the required return on equity or equivalently the cost of return earnings. الكمباني دي عندها earning, return earnings كفاية. She will not issue a new stocks. So we use the cost of return earnings as the cost of common stock. The calculation for Deutsche Corporation's WACC appears in table 9.22 in the other slide. The resulting WACC is 9.28. Let us hear in these lectures and we will continue in the second lectures how to solve many problems on this chapter. And good luck.